Hey guys, welcome back. It's Lucid and I'm joined by Marilyn. So we've got another quick turn for you. And I think Marilyn suggested this, let's do something kind of at the end to talk about. We'll talk about one of the nations and we'll muse about how can they win? And not like thrones necessarily, but like grand strategy, you know, like what are the moves that Ulm needs to do to turn this into a W?
Yeah, and that'll be at the end of the episode once we've kind of covered the messages and any critical battles.
Want to start us off with reading these messages from Pangea?
Sure. 54 slave vampire lords?
Woo.
If I could bank enough e-gems, which I should be able to do by trading my fire gems for them with Ulm, I could potentially overcast to use...
What an asshole. Well,
the question is... So I'm going to buy your gems from you and then screw you over. Oh, wow. The question then is, how worthwhile is that under Arcane Nexus? Spending gems now means that one quarter of them don't go into the Pearl Bank, and there is a very real chance that Vanheim or I will need to put up Astral Corruption. Then again, even a 160 gem Earthblood Deepwell pays for itself in 8 turns, or 4 turns if you count the minus 20 gems to all. And Earth Gems rule, so might be worth it.
Did Nexus go up?
This is not a
fail. Oh, it hasn't. They just aren't dumb. Surprisingly, Sai is not dumb. He knows it's coming.
This is not a favorite tactic of mine. I don't like arguing over gem globals, with the exception of Nexus. Because I find it a bit of a mug's game, in that you're pouring a bunch of gems on the hope that you get the payback. Some other guy is then going to overcast it again. And, you know, you get this cyclical arms race over what is strictly an economic global. A gem global is all they are, is pay now for more later. You know, it's putting money in the bank to get interest.
Yeah.
A lot of people forget that.
I think there's a few situations where they're like really profitable, you know, like when you're the first one to cast it and you're going to put the minimum amount in it, or you might put the minimum amount in it, nobody knows, right? But you're the first one to cast it and you know it's not going to get overcast for long enough for it to pay itself back.
Well, you remember we had our Disciples game where we rushed Maelstrom and it got knocked down so fast that was effectively a waste of gems.
But sometimes
And in that game, we never tried to put it back up again.
Yeah. So sometimes, Maelstrom's hard to like rush, you know, but
it is.
But sometimes you can get Earthblood Deepwell or like some other game, somebody got Eternal Pyre on like turn 15 or something, and it's like, Jesus Christ, you know, but like.
Yeah. Well, and Mother Oak frequently goes up very early and it pays off really quick.
So you can do that where you get it early and you know, just based on timing, you're going to have it, because people might not have had time to accrue enough gems to cast it or the research or whatever. And you know, you're going to have it for a while. The other case is if you just have a phenomenal income so that you think you can overcast enough that it'll take a while to pay back, but you just don't think somebody else is going to put that much into it at whatever stage in the game you're in, then it can kind of pay off.
Right.
But like the middle ground is a little tepid, where you're like, oh shit.
Well, one of the big exceptions for me on this is if someone is using their gem global to crash you, you might want to overcast it just to get rid of it, because it might be easier to overcast it than dispel it. That's a bit of an exception. Yeah. Like an example might be Maelstrom, and you're using it to support continuous cast event for water. I've seen that before. And so I've deliberately knocked down the Maelstrom so that then the Vengeful was able to be got rid of. But I'm just saying that overall, this is not a strategy I enjoy.
So interesting here, too, is this the first time we see mention of Astral Corruption? There's a very real chance that Vanheim or I will need to put up Astral Corruption. So you and I have been thinking about that for a bit, but we also are kind of a bit zoomed out.
Quite a while.
And Pelagia has been thinking about Astral Corruption since Pretender design.
Of course.
And he can't even cast it. So, but yeah, the cogs are starting to turn about what's going to happen in the late game, and Sai's starting to get ready.
Yes.
So, yeah, I don't actually like fighting for Earthblood Deepwell at this stage, because with Astral Corruption, it's going to be harder to spend gems. And with Pearls, Pelagia is going to get a rebate on whatever you manage to spend.
Well, and really, why wouldn't Pelagia help him recast it? Because then it's invisible. he doesn't look like he's making aggression against Pangaea,
right.
but he actually is. There's a bunch of things involved in this that get complicated.
So, oh God.
Oh,
the god
grief.
Comes back.
He called it back again. What?
I don't know.
Yeah,
what else is he going to do? I think he's...
Maybe just to mess with people.
He needs to do a rescue operation. That's what I want to see. Mm-hmm.
It's an odd...
So Pangaea's cracked. He sent a little scouting expeditionary force inside this turn.
Yeah. So that was cheap.
And there's some mages devil. In here, but I don't think there's a lot. Okay, he's got some Abbot Maguses, which, you know, these guys can do elementals and stuff, but...
Oh, for sure. That's quite a few of them left.
This is...
Oh, that's a lot of boosters.
Okay, he can do something. Yeah, I mean... They...
We aren't really good at...
He's got a bitch mother. It's not going to work. It's not going to work. He needs to have relief. He needs a bunch of elementals.
Doing with that ice elemental.
I think I don't even know if he scripted this. I mean, he's got gems for. I think that's fine.
Water gem. That's
yep.
good.
It's gonna be ugly. That's gonna be. Sai's gonna stomp the shit out of that next turn.
Okay, so he tossed up a horde from hell, but that's just an annoyance.
Yeah, and this was okay. So this fort he hasn't moved on top of. This fort. He's cracked now. I thought he had cracked that last time, but I guess not. He's still got to go through this fort, too.
And then the one on the throne. So there's a few more end forts, so it's going to be a couple more turns. Two, three more turns. Are we moving to the Ullman?
Oh, yeah. I think we're done. Let's take a look. So the god... Oh, no.
Okay.
This is a little poke from Ullman to see what's inside.
Oh.
Now, the god is magic phased inside the fort. He's got a bajillion magic resistance. Only 2 death gems.
He might be running low. Soul Vortex, and he goes to fight.
Okay. And this is all looking on lockdown. Do we have a message? So we don't have a message from Vanheim confirming that this turn he's going to end his nap with Pelagia.
Yeah, so we're looking at some action here in 2-3 turns.
Yeah, okay, let's do Ashdod next. Do you want to read this one for us?
Yeah. Doing mass remote site searching of Zabalban lads for his less common past. Good move. Doing the same for remote air searching basically everywhere. Also good move. My A2s now have the free cycles. I'm NAP'd on all sides except Uruk. See a concentration of banned stuff to my south, but I think he responded to the stuff I put on my border for an event. Well, we also know that Vanheim is massively blood hunting, so some of that concentration may just be patrolling. From the charts being shared in Diplo channels, Pan pulling ahead at province counts as he finishes end. This should hopefully be the last turn for Zabalba. I hear Satis not long for the game either. Looking at just maximizing gem income at this point, even if rate of investment lower now, still need to get what edge I can. Hoping to see someone else fight or a coalition form. Need the game to draw on a bit longer. Securing thrones in the next few turns. Focusing infrastructure. Zabalba's cap last turn.
Yeah.
Nice. Dropping temples, fording the misfortune throne, etc. He's doing what I kind of predicted, which was concentrate, improve his infrastructure, and wait to see how things shake out. Because if I was Ashdod, I would not want to be poking any of the big bears right now. He needs a little time to consolidate, get his blood economy going, hopefully try to fix his research.
Let's take a look at some of these graphs.
Yeah, particularly his research graph, because let's see if the slope increases.
Oh, wow. So this is Pangaea is ahead in army and province count now. That's a significant development.
It is a significant
I'll take a look at research now. Okay, he's definitely catching up.
Yeah, his slope is increasing, which is the... And the slope of Pan is stable, and the slope of Vanheim is stable. So neither is increasing, significantly adding more researchers, but Ashdod is adding more researchers. Or items, one or the other.
So that's interesting. Nope, go ahead and put everybody up here. That's a playa.
Yeah, we only have 5. Vanheim's well ahead on 4th, although Pan's going to jump up 3 or 4 or more very quickly.
Income?
Very close.
Gym income. Interesting.
Gym. It's closing. Gaps are closing. Gaps are closing.
Then research.
Okay. So Pam looks like, just from this graph, he feels like he's got most of the research he needs for the game. Because he's not demonstrating any effort to crank it up. That's kind of my
interpretation. Well, I think he's had to do... I think some of this has just been... To conquer Int, he's had to do a full court press on troop production. And then, I mean, we have to remember the kind of state he was in when he started fighting Int after the Vanheim conflict. You know, his army was in shambles. He'd lost a lot of mages. To win this war, he had to mobilize a ton of stuff and start switching to mostly troop production.
Yeah, we could kind of see a bit of a flattening of his research graph sort of right there where your mouse is. And that's probably when he said, I've got to roll out the Magi. Because I can't win these fights with just white centaurs now. I've got to have major.
And I don't know if he ever turned off mage production. Possibly he turned it on, but then sent them out to the warfront. I would not be surprised if he did. If he, especially for the first, you know, 4 or 5 turns of this war, if he was like, do I want to max out mage production every fort, or do I need maxing out centaur cataphracts every turn?
He might have also switched from pans to cheaper magi.
Yeah, that's the other thing too. So, yeah.
And he hasn't been using a lot of transformation to reduce his upkeep. I mean, some people are very fond of that.
And then Dominion, hands. Vanheim. This, he might be bloodsacking some now. Can he do that?
Yes, he can.
Yeah, let's double check real quick just to make 100% sure. Priests can perform blood sacrifices. Yeah, so he probably is with the Dominion graph like this.
Well, and I believe Van Girls are holy too, so that's pretty hefty sacrificing.
I think that's going on.
Oh, army size. That was the other one.
Yeah, Pan starting to go crazy with Maenads.
These are big armies. The only one that's kind of flat is all.
Yeah.
Well, he's flat. He's not particularly buying a lot of
troops. He used to be the income leader, but he's gotten knocked down pretty hard by Vanheim. So he's now number 3 for income. Yeah.
Mm. Okay. Well, that army size chart, the only surprise on that one was just that it's kind of flat for home, which I'm a bit surprised at.
We need to look at Pelagia. I don't know if there's anything happening, though.
I don't think there's anything really to see.
Yeah, I think that there's not too much to look at here. Pelagia's not giving us much food to talk about. Ashdod, we just read his message, so we need to see what happened.
Yeah. Well, this right here.
The final fort.
This is it. What's inside? Absolutely nothing.
Well, this has repelled the Ashdod attack before.
It has, but I don't think
that. Yeah, they're going to have something to say about these frozen heart spammers.
Yeah, boom, boom. Oh my gosh. Well, that was quick. Well, good games of Alba. Game. With Stone Troll and
Sauron.
And Sauron. And Balibi.
I think my toast to the bats will be y'all poked the bear? And you tried damn hard to outrun it, but you couldn't. But, you know, they made the bear run really hard, and the bear's really tired now.
Yeah, it is.
Good game, guys. There was a lot of good battles, highly entertaining stuff, really cool things they were doing with their scripts and their formations with a bunch of guys spread out all over the place with fatigue plays. It was really cool stuff. This is a nation we don't see that much. Middle-aged Zabalba is kind of like a... It's a non-obvious nation. You know, people are always wondering how to play it. I get that question all the time. So really cool to see it in a competitive game.
Yeah, well done.
I don't think we have more nations to cover, do we?
No, I think we could do our little talk about...
All right, who do you want to talk about?
Because that's the hardest. I think of all of them, Ulm has the hardest path to victory next. That would be my assessment. Of the 5 remaining nations, well, there's... Technically 7 nations still in the game, but I don't think there's any path to victory for Sidis or Uruk.
What do you think is the path to victory for Ulm? What do you think of the broad strokes of it?
I think, first off, he's got all the research he probably needs. So what he needs is massive diversification. And I think he also has to shift from his core recruitable troops to summons of some kind, or at least support it with summons. So top of the list, based on his gem income, I'd be, and I think his chances for elemental royalty are probably over because other people are going to take them now. So he needs things like liches, wraith lords, get his death magic up, make sure he's got enough astral magic, put together his communions, put together more matrices, make sure he's got lots of shaman, because we know he has shaman. He might have something like Sinophalians, or so I think he needs a broader diversity. He needs a broader selection of troops. He needs to roll out these big magic spells. He probably has to use smaller, medium-sized communions to get them off. Focus on forging boosters, because he can no longer rely on his core smiths with earth buffs. You know, he's got to broaden. He's got to have anti-magic in every major fight or army of lead. He might need army of gold, depending on who he has to fight next. So he might have to do anti-magic and army of gold. He needs the big enchantment aid resistances. He needs a decent amount of water magic.
So,
not a heck of a lot of
I've got a thought, Maryland. I've got.
You might want Clint.
I think, like, if we zoom out a little farther, even at like a big, big macro picture, we know Nexus is going to be coming up, and we know Astral Corruption is probably going to be coming up shortly thereafter. Which of those do you think is most punishing for Ulm by far?
Corruption. I think have a brutal time under
right and I think the thing that's most brutal about it is the defining competitive advantage that Ulm gets. They lose. They can no longer use that's their master right. smiths to forge stuff because they will probably die to horrors,
or he just has to accept that they're a bit suicidal and don't use hammers, and he has to forge at the higher price. It's still a decent price.
Yeah, that's true. And you just pay for them in gold.
And if you pay for them in gold, because the smith will probably die, but I noticed that when I was doing that under Astral Corruption with Late Age Pan, is yes, my centaurs were dying, but I was still getting the item. And if it was an item I really needed, then I just considered that an acceptable risk. I mean, we could look it up. It's available on
the wiki. It's also possible he could come up with a Astral Corruption kit that would be able to survive minor horror attacks, right? So a Ring of Returning, which he can make for sort of cheap, maybe, and a Coral Sword and a Dwarven Hammer and a Luck Hat and... You know, like maybe you can get a kit that will survive on average 20 turns or something through, because he's probably not going to get big horrors on one gem items. You know, it's probably going to be little horrors.
I kind of tried that when I was working, because I worked something like 30 turns under Astral Corruption, and you helped me out with the idea of golems, and that was helpful, but very hard for late age Pangaea to get golems going. Probably. You know, or on other mindless options. But what I found was it was actually cheaper. I think I saw statistics of around 1 in 4 of my 5-gem item forgers, and that was without hammers, was getting horror killed. Oh. So I still got 3 items and 3 magi that didn't get hit by a horror. The chances of the horror attacking on a 5-gem item are not that high. So I was still able to keep forging. It just you had to trade gold for items.
So and that's okay, but you know, Ulm doesn't really have a huge advantage there. Like the thing for Ulm is he gets 1 gem item. So having some way to preserve that advantage, I think, would be amazing. But you're right, it's not as bad as going back to 5 gems for a 5-gem item.
Well, the other issue is if you can forge those critical high gem cost items beforehand. Because matrices are 10-gem items and other things like that, and have them stockpiled. If you can get that before corruption goes up, because he has a bit of a moment now to sort of anticipate. And I'm kind of guessing that he's thinking, okay, these are the things I'm going to have to deal with next, Nexus and Astral. I don't think he has anything he can do about Nexus. It's just not something. The other unit he might want are Spectres. Or he could do some of the hidden spells if he can get them cast before corruption goes up. Hidden in snow or hidden in sand, or depends on the terrain he has.
So I think he's got some time to prepare for Astral Corruption. He needs to do that. Either doing kits on smiths with hammers that can survive so he can still make 1 gem items. I don't even know if it's possible. I'm suspicious it is possible.
I would also point out that at the grandest, highest level, he can't win if he can't survive. So he has to prepare for somebody.
Well,
to
that too. That's the things you were talking about with all the having the right magic with your armies, which he didn't really have before. So
that's what I mean.
Yeah.
Because he's vulnerable to a rush right now. Like if all three of them said, let's eat home. Then he's in the middle.
So I think that's actually, and I hope he's been doing some of that, but I think you're right. I think that to me, for Ulm, the first step on the path to victory is preparation, right? And he needs to prepare for being attacked, right? So getting where he can have all the magic in his army. And the second thing he needs to do is be ready for astral corruption. And he doesn't have to be fully ready for either, but you know, he needs to be well on his way to being ready. And then, okay, so let's say he's done that. Then what's the next step?
Well, there's another piece that just sort of came to mind here. We have talked previously that, and people have talked, that Ulm is a very powerful early mid-game nation, and then tapers off largely from the lack of the super scaling high power magic that other nations have. So that's where he has to move. He has to become a much broader nation than the core base that we've seen so far.
But let's think. So on one hand, I think he's a natural ally to Pelagia in that they both are going to hate astral corruption. So it's possible he positions himself to Pelagia that way and says, hey, look, you and I, astral corruption, I know you're going to do Nexus. They're going to put up astral corruption. We're going to need to probably work together against it because I don't like astral corruption at all. He doesn't neighbor Ashdod. And that's a kind of interesting thing. Ashdod won't mind astral corruption either, though.
Not as bad. Yeah.
I think the other thing for both of these small nations, and we'll talk about Ashdod specifically on another episode, but ideally what you need to do is be a third wheel in a war and get bought out or come to terms, right? So let's say Pelagia says, let's you and I go after Pangaea. Maybe you can even get Ashdod to join in. And he goes and gets some gains. And the problem he has to be careful is if he gets, this is the game you play as a small nation in these kind of wars. You want to get out before you've crippled them so much that the other player who may win, like maybe Vanheim or Pelagia or something, gets everything, right? Like you don't want Pelagia to eat Pangaea because then somebody's pulled way far ahead of you, but you do want some of the Pangaean land maybe.
I would bring another little tidbit towards his late game play. He might want to do, I guess I sort of was thinking of the three witches in Macbeth. He might want to brew up some diplomatic poison pills to stir the shit amongst the top three. I don't know if he has any way to stir the shit, but if he could kind of, you know, trigger something and then exploit that when the opportunity comes, or just be bloody ready when something develops, he can exploit it.
Yeah, I think he needs to do this preparation, but once the preparation's done, he needs things to happen. He's not okay where he is, right? So the preparation could be fast. The preparation could be like four or five turns.
And he differs from Ashdod there in that Ashdod could, instead of picking a fight, Ashdod could just build a gigantic blood economy and scale himself up. Ulm doesn't have that option. He's got no way to scale up his power right now.
Yeah, exactly. But he needs a bit of chaos and he's got to find, you know, a fight. So ideally, he's not the only person that's, you know, dealing with either probably Vanheim or Pangaea, fighting them with a few other people, getting a little bit of territory, piecing out, and maybe because he'll probably need to. Right. It's not just like, oh, you should peace out. He probably needs to so that whoever is now the big threat, he can help against them. And then before you know it, he'll be one of the big boys. Like he might be in position two or something. And then it's a long road. I think the other thing he needs to do is figure out what summons he's going to get and like break into you know, other things. So, yeah.
Yeah.
All right. Well, what do you put the odds at pulling this off for a W?
Oh, yeah. Very small. But there's no point not trying. So maybe the question is more rather than, does Ulm have a decent shot at the win? I would say no. But you want to do something, and just sitting and turtling is boring as hell.
And I do think there is a shot.
I'd want to.
It's not like there's 0% chance, but it would involve some pretty masterful shit and really good diplomacy, being aggressive when you need to, piecing out when you need to. Yeah.
And a bit of luck. Because you know, if a massive conflict starts building between Vanheim and Pan, well, then that's an opportunity. I don't think that will happen because I think they've had it fighting each other. They're sick.
They've played that game before and they don't like it.
No, no.
All right. Well, thank you for joining me, Maryland. And thank you all for tuning in. We'll probably have a few more slow episodes, and then I promise you we'll have some cool ones.
Oh, yeah, I know it's going to be picking up. How many turns behind are we now? Is that something we should
mention? Yeah, sure. We are 28 or something. They're getting close to 100.
Okay, right. And we were behind by almost 40 for a while. So
yeah, we're getting pretty close.
Yeah.
All right. Excellent. See y'all next time.